Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of 2 Kings. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing, yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of the darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark. Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Well, it has happened. Like an old man, I'm wearing bifocals. And I'm doing pretty well, except I have not quite mastered that looking down and looking back up and looking down thing. So if I lose my spot or fall out, you'll know the reason why. Somebody prop me back up and we'll keep going. Well, today, the last day before our Lenten fast begins, and let's count our blessings, shall we? I think it's a good day to do that. It's the last Sunday before Lent, but it's also our anniversary, mine and yours together. You called me to be your priest 8 years ago, and as of today, I have been here longer than I have ever been anywhere before as a priest, and have no plans of going anywhere either. So I hope you like me because you're stuck with me for a good little while. Fabia, good, thank you. I'll accept that. I like you too. It was February 1st, 2016, but I did not come to church until the next Sunday. First Sunday of Lent, which was very early that year, just like it is very early this year. And we don't talk about it very often, but when you all called me to be a priest, to be the priest here, there was no way that this parish could afford a full-time priest, especially not one who had been ordained for 13 or so years. Small, struggling parishes almost always call a newly ordained priest or a retired priest because that's what they can afford. And one of the things you all agreed to do in 2016 was to take that step out on your faith, and you knew that if you did not spend the seed corn to grow some crops, you probably would not have a field left to plant them in. It was scary, and I will make a confession to you, it was just as scary for the Joneses as it was for the resurrectionists, because we knew that this was not a sure thing. We left behind everything that was comfortable and stable and trusted that God was going to look out for all of us, and I think it ended up okay. But can you believe that? Just 8 years ago, this congregation was on the brink, really, it's not an exaggeration, was on the brink of financial collapse. We were considering giving up our status as a parish and becoming a mission congregation. We wouldn't have our own mission. We would be somebody else's. And that's really remarkable because God has blessed us in ways that I could never have asked or imagined. In no time at all, we were a healthy, growing place where just a few years ago, we were running about 40 on Sunday morning. And I don't mean 40 in this service. I mean 40 in all the services combined. And we could not pay the bills. You know, I don't talk about this very often, but we had $1 million building note and 40 folks trying to service $1 million building note, 10 families or so trying to serve $1 million business note. And Neil Graver said to me this morning Dustin's not here, but he was talking about Dustin. He's a heathen. Where is he? No. Neil this morning said, you know, our first Sunday, there were 12 people in church, and Dustin stood up and talked about why he was here and why this church meant so much to him. And Dustin reached out to him personally as they left, and he said, and we were out the door. We were never coming back until Dustin reached out to us personally, and they've been here ever since. It really does matter, right? You don't come back because of the programming. You come back because of the relationships that you make. It really is that important to reach out to folks, the folks sitting by themselves, the folks you don't recognize, every single Sunday. It really is that important. Now, I think there are a lot of reasons for the success that our little parish has had, and we can name them. One, Franklin, Tennessee is growing like crazy. Everybody wants to be here, and I don't blame them. I want to be here too. It is a great place to raise families. It's a great place to live. It's a great place to retire in. There are great schools. There are great people. People still go to church in Middle Tennessee. It's a wonderful place, and for us, it's home, and I don't ever want to live anywhere else. You ought to be able to grow a church here, right? It didn't take my Louisiana kids long to become Tennesseans. When you ask them where they're from, they'll tell you that they're from Tennessee. They won't tell you that they're from Louisiana. And another reason is that we have more than a handful of parishioners who have really signed on, who have gotten serious about telling people the good things going on here in their church and inviting them to come and see. And they've gotten serious about the good news of Jesus Christ too, and that is what it takes. Imagine if every single one of us was doing that, we'd be growing even faster than we are now. Now, three, we are putting together some pretty amazing programming. We're pulling off some stuff that a parish this size would not normally be able to pull off. And I know that there are sometimes frustrations. I wish we could be doing more. I wish we could be giving more to this ministry or that. But for a parish this size, we're getting there. We're getting there. Now, I still do think what I thunk before, that people come back for relationships, but good programming doesn't hurt, does it? It's good for all of us who are trying to hone our faith. Four is, and I think this is a bigger one than a lot of people do, we are not making the mistake that a whole lot of Episcopal churches are making right now, and that is getting bogged down in political issues. I don't think you come to church to hear what I think about the political issues of the day. I think you're smart enough people on your own that you don't need my help from the pulpit. We come here to talk about Jesus, and that's what we do. Now, these are some of the big reasons that we're growing, and I'm sure that you can name others as well, other things that have contributed, but those are the big ones that we can put our fingers on. But that does not explain all of it. That doesn't explain it all. There are a lot of parishes around the world, around the state, even in the diocese, that have got a lot of things going for them, and they have not seemed to hit upon the right recipe yet. I can't tell you how many times a group of clergy will be sitting around talking about a parish, and someone will say, you know, I just don't understand why that church is not growing. It ought to be growing. It's in the right place. It's got good people. It's got this. It's got that. And it just isn't. Some churches seem to have everything they need for success, but things just don't seem to pan out for them sometimes. And what is it that we have that not everyone else has? And I think the best answer that I've got for that is sometimes you just cannot explain the blessings of God. God falls firmly into that other than category, and we will spend our whole lives trying to get closer to him. But like Paul says in the lesson we heard this morning, even as hard as we try to get close to him, it's still like we're walking around with a veil over our minds. And we won't see God clearly until we see him face to face. The Bible stresses that over and over again. You know, when Moses argued with God, when God told him he was going to have to go to Pharaoh and speak, and Moses argues and said, but I don't speak very well. There's something wrong with my speech. And God kind of rolls his eyes and said, Moses, Did you make man to speak? Where were you when I put the voice in his body to start with? Let me be God, and I'll take care of all that. From the whirlwind, he asked Job, Job, where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? There are just some things that we cannot understand right now, is what God means by that. And that's one of the lessons we'll struggle with in our time. It's a hard one to learn, but it's a good one once you've learned it. In the gospel lesson this morning, we hear the same lesson we always hear before Lent begins. We hear about the transfiguration. Jesus takes with him just a few people up on that mountain to pray, and while they were there, something strange happens, something very odd. Jesus' face begins to glow with the glory of God. The heavens open up and descend on the mountaintop, and the voice of the Father booms out. The prophets return to earth, and the three disciples who were there were terrified at what was going on, and they spend the rest of their lives trying to figure out exactly what that was. Well, you know, for 2,000 years, the church has been talking about what happened on that mountain. I'm not sure we have it figured out yet, even. Jesus begins talking to the prophets about what's going to happen in Jerusalem, which is the crucifixion. And Peter just cannot stand it. He can't understand why they would be talking about allowing this to happen. And he tries to jump in and save Jesus from his death. But what does Jesus say? Jesus, who is God from God, what does God say? Well, he says the same thing he always says, which is, Peter, you be Peter, and let me be God. It's what he said to Moses. It's what he said to Job. And it's what he says all the time. God can shower down his blessings on whomever he pleases because he's God. And when he does that, we just say thank you. Now, we don't have any better notion today of what happened up there on the mountain than Peter did when it happened. But I know what it makes me realize. It makes me realize that God is God and we are not. We didn't lay the foundations of the earth. We didn't breathe life into our own bodies. He is the one who did that. He brought his people across the Red Sea on dry foot. He authored our salvation on the cross on Good Friday. And he looked down upon this sweet, wonderful little church. And he opened up the storehouses of heaven and rained his blessings down on us simply because he is God. Now, some things cannot be explained. We're quick to call God out for the bad things. Some people are quick to call God out for the bad things. Why did this happen? Why did that happen? Why did you let this happen? Well, why don't we start telling folks about the wonderful and the miraculous things that have no explanation at all? Why don't we make a list of those things and store those in our hearts, write them on our hearts, thanking him with our lips and in our lives, thanking him for the mercy that he has shown to us, being on the lookout for it, and being eager to show others what it is that the Lord has done for us and the blessings that he has showered upon us. And thank goodness, we worship a God who is faithful every single time, because it means when we hit a bump in the road, a little bump or a big bump, we can be at peace that God's already working on that for us. Let's let God be God. Our problems pose absolutely no challenge to the God who sang creation into existence. Just sit back and let him do what he does. And I promise you, we will watch miraculous things happen. I promise. The only thing we need to do is to show up on Ash Wednesday and worship him as the Lord who moves mountains and forgives us of all of our sins. Amen. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church, that we all may be one. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray especially for St. Matthew's Church, McMinnville, and the province of the Episcopal Church of South Sudan. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble, that they may
be delivered from their distress.
We pray especially for Mary, Dick, Diane, Mary Jane, Mac, Patty, Ann, Carla, Rick, Jonna, Clay, Scott, Rich, Colson, Margie, Brittany, Jessica, Ben, Arlene, Carlos, and Louise. We pray for those in service of our country, especially Douglas, Jeffrey, Stephen, Cameron, Jack, John, Kurt, Christy, Christopher, Danny, Tyler, Jacob, Maggie, William, Patrick, David, and Allie. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. You're all right. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in everlasting life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Well, this week is a big week for us. Monday, Lundi Gras, is known as shopping day at the Church of the Resurrection. We will spend the day grocery shopping and trying to find a place to put all the chickens and the sausages and all of that so that we can make gigantic pots of gumbo on Tuesday. So if you're out and about and want to help us chop onions and bell peppers and celery and everything else, come on by on Tuesday, and we'll be doing that all day long. We'll be ready to go about 6:30 for our Mardi Gras dinner. Bring something to share if you want to. We like our Louisiana theme, but it doesn't have to be Louisiana theme. As long as I can eat it, you can bring it. We take that party fairly seriously at Church of the Resurrection because we take Ash Wednesday very seriously. There's no reason to come to the party if you're not going to come to Ash Wednesday. So I will see you all on Tuesday evening so that we can all be here together at noon or at 6:30 on Ash Wednesday for our Ash Wednesday liturgies. Confirmation classes are about to begin. We're going to start those in April, and we have much better luck on Wednesday evenings than we do on Sunday mornings with all of our classes. We call it Wednesday school instead of Sunday school. So we will we'll begin confirmation classes on the Wednesdays in April, the 3rd, the 10th, the 17th, and the 24th, and then we'll have a makeup day on the 27th. You may have noticed that I culled back the prayer list a little bit. If somebody has come off the prayer list that needs to be put back on it, just let us know, and we will do that right away. Now, on Tuesday night, sometimes we have a little fundraising event on Thursday, a little ahead of myself, on Mardi Gras, and sometimes we don't. We have got a little project this year that we've got a good chunk of seed money for, so we have decided to have a little silent auction for our landscaping project. So if landscaping is your thing, you can give a little bit to that, and if landscaping is not your thing, then you can just come and eat gumbo like we normally do. That'll be just fine. Sarah, you had something to say about that, didn't you? Great. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. The more people who sign up for coffee hour, the less frequently you have to do it. Right. Yay, that's great. Okay, thanks, Sarah. I appreciate that. If you are interested in what we're talking about with our landscaping project, Kelly Arnold, who I think stepped out, Kelly Arnold has put together a nice little presentation for us in the Crossroads. We've got big pictures hanging up so you can see what she's got in mind. And I think that's all I've got. For anything, Frank? We're okay. All right. Yes, sir.
Vestry meeting tomorrow night.
That's right. That's right. After the grocery shopping. Right. So John's also reminding me that the diocesan convention was yesterday, and it was as riveting as it always is. However, I will say about convention this year that we had the privilege of hearing Timothy Kimbrough. You may remember Timothy Kimbrough from sabbatical time. We had the privilege of hearing him. He's retired from the cathedral, and he's at Duke teaching now. He's a professor at Duke, and he came back to preach. Maybe one of the top five sermons that I've ever heard. It was outstanding, and I'm not going to tell you anything more about it because I might recycle some of it for our Ash Wednesday service, our Ash Wednesday sermon. I hope I can tell it as well as he told it. It was very fine. Didn't you think so? It was a very fine sermon. Any birthdays this week or anniversaries? You? Is it your birthday or your anniversary? Valentine's Day birthday. That's right. I do remember that. You're our love, Miss Mary.
Thank you. You are too.
Watch over your servant, Almighty God, as her days increase, and bless her as she stands. Hold her up when discouraged or sorrowful, and on that great last day, bring her to that company of saints in light, where she will reign forever with you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Mm-hmm. We love you. Happy birthday. Thank you. Any anniversaries? Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice unto God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give. Now that's tricky. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
Thank y'all for that. That's just one of my favorite anthems. That was beautiful. Thank you so much. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you forever. Amen. in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Anybody but the Niners. Thank you.